Tears dance. Let that river of life wash it all away.
Take its claim over my heart.
Good morning. I'm Pastor Misuk Yu and glad to worship with you today. Wherever you are on the journey, you are always welcome. Please sign in your attendance at the church website, gocumc.org, especially those who are joining us online. If you're here with us for the first time, please stop by the welcoming podium. We will love to talk to you and answer some of the questions you might have for us. And just a word of precaution, I hope you had a wonderful Thanksgiving Day with your family and your friends. But please, if you are not feeling well or have some symptoms of COVID, stay at home. You can still join us online. We still want to this place is safe for us together. And we have, you know, next 4 more weeks and this journey through Advent and Christmas season. So let us stay well and create and offer safe place for us together. Today is the last day that you can put a poinsettia order. So there is the form inserted in your bulletin, and you can drop it at the offering plate today. Did you get the Giving Tree tag to support our adopted family for the season? And I just picked one. I was lazy one. And all the fun little ones, you know, children's ones are gone. So I tried to pick the next best one I can get it. So please pick that up if you have not done that yet. And let us just be generous in this season as we share the spirit of Christmas and the love of Christ. And all the unwrapped gifts and donations need to be back by December 8th. So today and next Sunday, you have 2 more Sundays, the chances. And we have a wonderful outreach opportunity to connect with our neighbors this Advent. And we are hosting Walk Through Bethlehem this Saturday. And I just want to invite, she's been leading this group, this event for many years. Janet, would you come forward and say some words?
Yes, we have been doing Bethlehem Marketplace since 2008, and we had to improvise with COVID, but it is this Saturday from 1 to 3. We still need some people to sign up. You don't have to do anything, learn any script or anything. We'll provide everything. Becky will have your costume ready for you. You will put it over top of your clothes, so you don't need to worry about getting cold, we hope. We have hand warmers, foot warmers. So we still need some people to sign up, and this is an outreach, as Pastor said, to our community, to our children especially. We have activities for the children to take home with them, so we hope that you can support us and see you this Saturday.
Thank you, Janet. And I know this is kind of not comfortable thing for you to do, and we went out with the youth group 2 weeks ago, deliver little gifts from our church to our neighbors in the street mall. And my most recent experience, when we had the trunk or treat, accident happened, and all the cars been just, you know, lining up in our here in the corner. So I just brave, you know, I took the courage and I went out, and all the people in the line passing out those little gifts, and it's not a comfortable thing for me to do as a pastor too. But why don't you try? There's an invitation card right here inserted in your bulletin today. If you know any family or neighbor, friends you know have a children, give it to them and tell them. We have this wonderful event this Saturday, so invite them. Can we try? Let's try our best. All right, good. And we have a little bit different order of worship during this season of Advent, so I invite you, please rise in body or spirit for the call to worship. This is a responsive reading. Can one be homesick for something you've never known? Yes, we are homesick. We are homesick for the world God promises. God is here. God is still creating. Amen. Now let us sing our first song, opening song, All Our Days Waiting. Now I invite Tom and Schaller to come and light our first Advent candle.
Bridges than walls.
We hope for a world with wide open doors.
We hope for a world with contagious laughter.
We hope for a world where trees grow tall and creeks run clean.
We hope for a world where all people feel at home, in their bodies, in the church, in their physical homes.
We hope for that world.
We long for that world.
We are homesick for that world.
So today we light the candle of hope, because hope keeps our hearts alive as we walk.
May this light be a reminder that the wait is always worth it.
We are close to home. May we carry hope with us.
Amen.
Amen.
Even so, Lord Jesus, come.
When we call upon God to confess that we are messed up or forgotten something or overlooked the truth, God answers with grace. God answers with love. So let us confess today, knowing that nothing could keep God from loving us. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we find ourselves with two options every day: to stay homesick for the world you had in mind, or to allow cynicism to win. Do we hope against hope, or do we throw in the towel? Do we insist on a better world, or do we assume it's possible? Forgive us for the days when cynicism wins. Forgive us for numbing our homesick hurt instead of using it to fuel a better world. Kindle in us a hope that won't let go. Gratefully we pray. Amen. Family of faith, even when we throw in the towel, even when we give up on hope, God does not give up on us. We are loved. We are claimed. We are invited closer to God's home. So hear and trust this good news. There is room for us in God's house, and nothing can separate us from that love. We are claimed. We are forgiven. We are welcomed home. Thanks be to God. Amen. Now I invite our children to come forward. Where are our children today? Come. Hi, Ruby. You go all the way back? You want to be close there or close to me? Wherever. You want to come over there? Hello, Maria, Sophia, Julia. Good to see you all. How are you guys? You ate lots of turkey? What's your favorite dishes for holiday, like Thanksgiving and Christmas? Cornbread. Hot mashed potatoes? How about you like a pumpkin pie? No? Which pie did you have then? Apple pie or no? No pie? Different dessert? Okay, that's okay. Right. I think I gained a couple pounds after the Thanksgiving day. Ate too much, right? Today, we start something new, and as you can look around, do you see any particular color, one color, a lot you can see? Look around here. What's the one color? You can find it in me. What's the one color you can see? Blue, right. Bright, this kind of a loyal blue. And how about right there? On the wall behind the keyboard, Shalom was beautifully playing this morning. Do you know what we call that? The blue fabric right there, and there's like a hands. And can somebody read that on the fabric? What does it say? Close to home. We call it banner, and we have a new banner today. But let's see. What do you think those, the painting or whatever there, that the image actually try to tell us, what that symbolizes? Can anybody guess? Ruby, what does it look like over there? I'll walk. Yeah, what does it look like? Do you see some hands? Looks like a hand, right? And what's in the center? So those hands are like holding something is in the center. What does it look like? Hole? It's a home. And can you see each end up there, that direction open, and the other way down is open? Do you see that? Right, right. So that symbolizes two hands building like a home. But that's not one person's hand. We are building something together. So one hand is like a God's handing, helping us, giving us ability and power to do that. The other hand is our hand. So when we make a better world, world filled with hope and joy. We have to work together. We become the partners of our great God. And the center is a home, but it's ever growing. That's why there's a both ends open. It's ever expanding. And that's why we're going to whole month, this the Advent Christmas season, that's our theme we're going to talk about and think more and share with others. Did you receive this ornament, your Advent bag? Yes. So if you have not done that yet with your family, please try to think about what does home mean to you. Maybe home means to you lots of eating turkey together, right? Or home means you stay warm or have lots of laughter with each other, whatever. So you can write it down, the words, or put the colors, paint, but think about that. What does it really home for you? And where is your home? You know your address. Where do you live, Ruby? Somewhere by the river in Algonquin, right? Okay, that's good enough. I don't want to say your address then. I cannot remember your address. But home is maybe more than just our physical location. Like your town you live in where? Which city? Maria? Huntley, right? Joel's living in Huntley, right? And our church is in where? Algonquin, right? But home is more than physical location. It can mean a lot of things for us. So let us think about that, not only our children, but our whole church family through this season. Can you pray with me, your hands together, bring it close to your heart, and let us pray. Gracious Lord, we find our home whenever we gather as your children and as sisters and brothers in Christ in this place. So God, show us the way how we can live together as a one family and watch over these your beautiful children wherever they are, either at home or at school or every elsewhere. Let them always stay healthy and strong, and let them grow as your faithful disciples. We pray in your holy name. Amen. Amen. Okay, now you can go to your Sunday school. Oh, Mr. Gary is your teacher. You're going to have lots of fun. Okay, where we are now? Hearing our words, the scripture, Richard.
Our scripture reading this morning is from Luke chapter 21, verses 25 through 36. There will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and on the earth distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the seas and the waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, stand up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Then he told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on guard so that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness, and the worries of this life, and that day does not catch you unexpectedly like a trap.
Would you pray with me? God of the stars and God of our hearts, our days will pass, the earth might fade, our memories might blur, the grass will wither, the sky could go dark, but your words will last. So as we listen today, Help us hold on to what will last. Help us hold on to you. Gratefully we pray. Amen. Oops. Happy New Year. Did you think that I said these words mistakenly? It's only November. If you didn't know yet, Advent is the beginning of the new liturgical year. So it is very appropriate to say this New Year's greeting in church. Don't say that, go out in the shopping center or who is not Christian, but as a Christian, it's okay. It's actually the proper way we say that on the first Sunday of Advent. The church's calendar is cyclical rather than linear. So there are patterns of events that are repeated. The scriptures from the both Old and New Testaments are arranged to be read and preached in the year A, B, and C, which we call lectionary. Have you ever heard that, Tom? Lectionary, that's what it means. So after we go through those three-year cycle, we go back to year A again. So every 3 years, if you follow the lectionary text, you hear the same story coming back, over and over again. So today, we are entering year C, following the lectionary and the given text. What Richard just read for us is not easy to digest. Not my favorite on the first Sunday of Advent. If you expected a whimsical story of an angel's visit, you probably were disappointed to hear the gospel reading. It sounded more like a doomsday, the end of the world. It may sound off-putting, but it actually makes sense to hear this passage today because we call this season the season of anticipation or expectation. We are waiting for the coming of the Christ child and also the coming of his new age with his reign. Yes, the word Advent means. Anybody knows the word Advent? Advent in Latin or Greek, what's the meaning of Advent? I'll give you a gift. Try. What's the Advent means? Coming. And the similar English word, adventure, like the coming. So we await for the birth of the newborn king, the coming of the Lord. So the biblical text points us to Jesus' apocalyptic teaching today. The passage starts with a harsh description of all those signs with the suns and moon, and the final days, the seas will roar, and the cosmos will shake and cause people to faint in fear. The Son of Man will come on in a cloud with such a great splendor and with power. Okay, we are kind of familiar with that story. There's been movies about the last day of the world. And we have had more than enough natural and human disasters that scare us. We got that part. But the next question, so what? Was Jesus' point to make us afraid of these final judgment days and live the rest of our lives in angst and panic mode? Whenever there is an earthquake or wildlife, a disaster or abnormal climate that frightens us, many of us think the end of time is getting closer. Some people make underground bunkers and get ready for the final days. Their focus is all about the uncertain future. Some people, on the contrary, they don't care about what will happen tomorrow. Just to try to enjoy the life by seeking instant pleasure, whatever that may satisfy them. Some people have tried to predict the judgment day, but they never succeeded. And some religious leaders manipulate people's fear, anxiety, and they build their power and wealth in such ill, dangerous, and harmful ways. Instead of living in terror and hopelessness, Jesus tells us to stand tall and raise our heads and look up. Jesus says to stay alert, pay attention to here and now. Not for the uncertain future or just waste our days here. Here and now, so whenever the Lord returns, we are ready. I love to watch the trees, and it is interesting to hear that Jesus talks about a fig tree in the passage today. So this image of a fig tree appears over 50 times in the scriptures. I know healthy eaters love figs this day. Anybody eat that often, figs at home? But it was even more critical, very important source of the nutrition and also economy in ancient time. So the bountiful fig tree symbolizes prosperous ancient Israel in the Bible, if ever listening to the Bible stories relate to fig tree. So the opposite, when it's fruitless and withered, then means something is not going well. That's why prophets used this image when they predict God's judgment on Israel too. Do you remember Jesus cursing a fruitless fig tree along the road to Jerusalem? And in today's text, Jesus used this image as a sign for the end time. Why? Because among those all various many trees in his time, this is the last tree to produce leaves, green leaves, right before summer starts. Until like 2 or 2.5 weeks ago, I think I was still able to see the beautiful colors in the fall leaves on the trees, but now they look almost barren. Anybody has those beautiful trees around your home, your neighborhood? The leaves fell to the ground, the trees look a bit dreary. In the northwest suburb of Chicago, we have to live with this shabby scenery for the next several months through a long winter, whether we want or not. And I'm wondering how many of you may go to Florida or Arizona this winter, get away a little bit. But these barren trees will remind me once again of the life hidden, life sustained in them, because they will be the first announcement of spring and summer and fall in the endless circle of life. I like those color changes from winter, a little bit brown and then pink, and then it turns like green new sprout, green colors coming up. So when I look at the barren winter trees, I anticipate full colors with greens, yellows coming back soon. I am not depressed by their shabby look, yet I see the strong will of life in them. And I can imagine the hands, like those hands in our banner, God's hands holding them as our ground of being, holding them up. All lives are sustained. I do not wait for the trees to wake up to spring by doing nothing, but I pay attention to God's signs of life. It's everywhere around me and in the little tree. I want to live like them by standing still through the winds and storms and snow, all the seasons of life, the good and bad. So friends, this teaching of Jesus to stay awake, pay attention, is not a message of fear, but a message of hope. Instead of waiting for the final days in dread and worry, instead of passively waiting for an end, whether that is disastrous or glorious, we are lived in this moment as if this is the last day of our life. Christ already came to us in human flesh 2,000 years ago, yet we are still waiting for his second coming, the return. We are already living in his reign as our Lord and Savior here on earth. We can foretaste the kingdom of God here, but it is not fully realized yet. We are living with God, God's presence right here and now, but our spirits are ever homesick for the fulfillment of God's kingdom, where there is no more war, strife, hunger, poverty, suffering, and pain. The perfect kingdom where God's justice rules and God's righteousness and mercy prevail. So this is the Christian paradox, as I shared in the Ineos blog. We live in this tension of already and not yet. That's another image I catch from these hands too. Already and not yet. Living in between as the citizens of earth and also the citizens of heaven, we may never feel at home completely. Nevertheless, God is never far away from us. God is so close to us, as close as our own breath. God comes to us again and again, breaking into our homesick world to heal us, to restore us, to love us, and show us the way to live together as one family. The commentator of our worship series, Elder Bill Murray Oliveri, talks about what we can reflect on in today's passage from Luke 21 as we begin the Advent journey. Let me read her quote. She says, "We remember how far from home we are. And I know I have my home country really far physically. But you also have your place. Originally, you had to move from. We are all far from home. The world is not as it should be. Many have lost their physical homes. Many feel alone, and many are isolated. Many of us feel as if we are wandering with no clear way forward. And the first week's words speak to our deep longing for our home to be made whole, made right, and made well. With deep longing, we watch for God." So this season, may we stay awake and watch for the signs of God's presence, the close presence within us, among us, and around us. May our deep longings turn into expectant hope for the world as we reach out to those people who are weary and lonely, who are crying, those who are hungry and hopeless. So be it. Amen. This moment, we lift up our hearts, prayers, for our family, friends, church family, and neighbors, and community, and the world. This morning, I ask your prayers. Are the prayer chain members already received the message? But Linda White is recuperating at home. She had some emergency room visit on Friday, so she's feeling much better, but I ask your continued prayers for Linda White. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And we have Elentine and Josh and Joel are here, and Brighton is on the plane right now heading his home in India. The Monday night will be his father's first memorial service with the family there. So he had a little episode, you know, he has to rebook his flight second time. But yeah, I talked to him, and for the safe trip going there and coming back, he will be back end of December here. So prayers for a safe trip and a meaningful time with the family. And I also remember other families who also still grieving the loss of their loved ones. So Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And Corinne's here. Corinne requested prayers for her mom, Rose. She will have a surgery on a both leg because of the 100% blockage, and they're going to put some stents. So Corinne's going to be with her. She's going out tomorrow. So care for her, so for a successful surgery and full recovery. I ask your prayers for Rose. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And we still have this prayer jar that we've been praying for our district churches. And now all of you 100% should remember, which district are we? Yes, very good. I think I have to reorder you, everybody. So we only have three more churches, and today I'm gonna pick another church here. He says Glen Allen first. Yes, so it's really can go all the way south far from here. So Glen Allen First Church, the pastor is Daniel Diss. He usually go by Dan Diss, so he's the leading pastor there. So pray for Glen Allen First United Methodist Church this week, and they can be a vital congregation who be the light in the local community right there. And we have our hearts prayers, so let us lift up our silent prayer to God and pray together. God of the weary and waiting, Scripture tells us that where two or more are gathered, you are there. So we trust that you are here with us, listening to these words, drawing us close, stirring hope awake in us, and for that we are grateful. Today, Holy God, we feel close to home, close to you. When the candles are lit, when we enter this space and someone knows our names, we feel close to home when our children are curious, when we find moments of true connection, when we are brave enough to be who you call us to be. However, God, even with gratitude for those moments, we also recognize that buried deep within us, we have homesick hearts. We are homesick for a world where oceans are clean, trees are green, and animals are not endangered. We are homesick for a life where days feel expensive and Sabbath feels possible. We are homesick for days where mental health is not stigmatized, time is not a commodity, and self-worth is not a scarcity. God, who never leaves us alone, we are carrying both hope and homesickness at all the same time. Hold those two sides of the same coin tenderly and fan the flame of both, for we realize hope is a gift, and homesickness is a reminder. For each conviction, we give you thanks. And now with the confidence of a children of God, We pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And we'll sing our sending forth song, Your Peace Will Make Us One. Would you please rise in body or spirit? You're going to recognize this familiar tune. Let us sing.
I've seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. You are speaking truth to power. You are laying down our swords, replanting every vineyard till a brand new vine is born. Your peace will make us one. I've seen you in our home fires burning with the quiet light. You are mothering and feeding in the wee hours of the night. Your gentle love is patient. You will never fade or tire. Your peace will make us one. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Your peace will make us one. The glory in your bosom that is still transfiguring, dismantling our empires till each one of us is free. Your peace will make us one. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
The homesick, open your doors to others, seek sanctuary, be brave enough to go home by another way, and remember that here in God's house, all are welcome. So come back soon. In the name of our foundation, God, the Son, and the Spirit, go in peace. Amen.